imagine if you just, the door is open in front of you, like, yeah, like you're somebody, like it's not very important. Anyway, that is important because this concert was supposed to happen a little while ago, and due to COVID restrictions and concerts being canceled, we're so happy that we could move it to tonight. You're going to hear some works of mine. Unlike some of the promotions you may have seen, it's not an entire night of my music. I wouldn't wish that on even my wife. But you're going to hear a piece I wrote for these two gentlemen about 20 years ago, and a piece that I just wrote recently that we've been waiting through these delays to finally have the world premiere tonight. And I'll step back on stage prior to each of those pieces and tell you about that, as they will be talking about the pieces from some of the other composers as we go along. I want to invite you, as always, we have reception afterwards right out in this lobby. Please join us, talk to the musicians, talk to each other, talk to me, say hello, let me thank you for being here. And again, I'm real excited to have this concert happening, so thank you for being here.
thank you very much for coming out this evening. Really is a great pleasure to be back here in Lexington at the Summerflex series. We were here maybe 5 years ago. I can't really remember. Maybe it was more than that. I've been here a few times. Love playing here. This next piece that we're playing is the Bloc Nigun, and that's from a suite of three movements called Valshem that Bloc wrote. And it's not uncommon for this to be played as just this single movement, the Nigun. Nigun means melody, and for Bloc, he used a lot of influence from Jewish melodies. A lot of his music sounds like folk Jewish melodies, but they're not actual folk melodies. They're melodies that he wrote to sound folk. And he thought it was a good idea, you know, to help him differentiate himself as a composer, was to have this kind of a sound. This piece was dedicated to the memory of his mother. So it's a very passionate and filled with some sadness and pain. But I find the ending kind of almost a sense of acceptance. But there's a reason that I chose this piece tonight. David Riley and I, and Terry Vosbein, all went to the same school, the Cleveland Institute of Music, a long time ago. We won't say that. But it wasn't at the same time as Bloc. Bloc used to be the director of the School of Music, Cleveland Institute of Music, from 1920 to 1925. And he wrote this piece in Cleveland halfway through his tenure there. So I thought this was a nice way to tie this four of us all together tonight. So here is Bloc's Nigun.
Thank you.
Pursuit of Happiness, and that's composed by our wonderful friend Terry Bosvine. So I'd like to invite Terry up to say a few words.
I've had the pleasure of writing music for these guys for 30 years. Jasper didn't want to say how long ago it was, but I'll say I was 11 at the time. For 30 years, I've had the pleasure to write for these magnificent musicians. This next piece I wrote for them about 20 years ago. They premiered it on a tour of the East Coast, and I think they were in the Black Box at the time in the next building. And I've written a lot of music since then, and as I was listening and thinking about, like, what could I say about this, and I came across a little thing I wrote about this piece 20 years ago when I wrote it, and I thought that this might be a good thing to share with you here. The pursuit of happiness is perhaps one of the most well-known phrases in American history. Our forefathers declared it an unalienable right in our Declaration of Independence. Wars have been fought defending it, yet no one can completely define it. This right, guaranteed to us merely for being alive, is not a promise of happiness. It offers us the freedom to pursue happiness, to chase our dreams, to find our thread, and to follow it. In each of the five movements of the sonata, I explore a person who has touched me personally with their pursuits of happiness. In the first movement, A Passion, the music moves forward constantly. The initial theme is brought back again and again, backwards and forward, never quite out of sight. A slightly schizophrenic pianist tries to lure the violin from its course with devilish stride effects, but by the end of the movement, they've united in their pursuit. The next movement, A Dream, is a set of three variations on a theme which is never heard. Dreams are magical. They're necessary to the pursuit of happiness. To understand one's dreams and to have the courage to follow them throughout life, that is what this movement is about. The middle movement is a romp. There's virtual perpetual motion piece all over almost before it begins. It's the lightest movement of the sonata, full of the kind of running eighth notes that should accompany any high-spirited romp. In A Tragedy, the dark side of pursuing happiness comes to the forefront. Sometimes we misunderstand our dreams, or we become distracted along the way. With the right kind of luck, we find our way back to the path. When one is not so lucky, the results can be tragic. The finale, A Wish, is a syncopation-filled movement that is off and running from the first measure. With every birthday candle blown out, with every coin tossed in a fountain, with every shooting star, we wish. So natural. Themes from previous movements appear amidst the wish. So I hope you enjoy the pursuit of happiness. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the next piece of the program is for solo violin. Dave's going to come back to that, don't worry. It's by Eugène Bizet. He's a Belgian composer. And he wrote six sonatas for solo violin, kind of in honor of Bach's six sonatas and partitas for solo violin. I've been a big fan of all of the sonatas, performed them all. This one I performed probably the least. But this particular movement, the Fugato, is one that I've been kind of obsessed with. Maybe not for concerts or that, but just because the, you know, being a melodic instrument, playing a fugue on it, especially such a long melodic fugue, it's really challenging to bring out different colors and different sounds and keep it resonating. And so I was kind of using it as a practice tool, just to, you know, through my days, I guess during COVID, you know, when I wasn't really playing concerts, finding new things to keep me going. But the last time I played here, I played Bizet's Sonata Number 3, so I thought it might be a nice touch to add in just a little bit of Bizet's. So here is Bizet's Fugato from the Sonata Number 1.
Thank you. So the next piece we're going to perform is the Suite Popular Espanol by Manuel de Falla. And de Falla was a Spanish composer, and he wrote this work in 1914. And it was originally for voice and piano, so there are poems that go with each piece. And each of these six movements deals with, as you might expect, courtship and love. And some of the pieces are playful, and some are serious, and one is rather tragic, and one is vengeful. And I'm sure you'll be able to tell which one that is. So I hope you enjoy this set.
Thank you. Thank you.
next piece we're going to perform is a premiere by Terry Boswine, and we'd like to ask Terry to come up and just say a few words about his piece.
Thank you. So about 6 years ago, my wife and I were spending some time at the Outer Banks, and I was meandering around and came across the Wright Brothers park there, memorial, where these first flights back in 1903 took place. And let me in a little composer's secret here. Most of the time, the titles come well after the music's written. In fact, that piece they played on the first half, I knew the kind of people I was being inspired by, but I wrote the piece and then I said, oh wait, this could be called a passion. And I signed names to them based on the music I had written. And that's generally how most of my music and a lot of people's music. This one, while I was out there in Kitty Hawk and looking at this place and imagining what they did, I thought they made a bicycle fly. These two bicycle mechanics. And the title was there before I even conceived of how the piece would unfold. As the piece did unfold, what I was trying to capture, and what amazed me about that first flight was there are actually several flights. The first one, which is documented in probably the most famous photograph in history of one Wright brother flying around while the other Wright brother's running next to it. The first flight took like about 100 feet and it went, and they knew we got something here. And they repeated it several times. And the first few were about 100 feet or so, or just past that. But then they took off and this thing really took control, and they went almost 900 feet under their own power. And I imagine what it must have been like running the controls, and is it going to stay up, is it going to soar? Each one of these trips that they took eventually came down. They pulled it back up the hill and they tried it again. That's what you're going to hear. You're going to hear those. The first ones are a little bit shorter. You'll hear the plane soaring and then coming down, and they're pulling it back up, and the next one's a little bit longer until finally they're just soaring, and you can imagine the feeling they must have had, the euphoria of this and what they've done. So that's what I tried to capture. It's been several years between some health issues and not to mention a pandemic of getting this thing premiered. So I'm really, really excited to bring this place and to finally having presenting it to an audience. So I hope you enjoy this. Thank you.
Maurice Ravel. This is a rhapsody of a concert piece. It was written for a famous violinist at the time, Jerry Grani. Was actually the niece, the great niece of Joseph Joachim. So she was a very fine violin virtuoso. And then when she commissioned this work from Ravel, she asked for a real showpiece, a piece to kind of show off all the different effects that can be done on the violin. So Ravel came up with this gypsy-inspired piece. It starts off with the first page of the violin part being all on the G string, kind of show different things that can be done on one string. Then he's kind and he gives us more strings for the second page. And then he gives us kind of a flurry to the piano and the violin together. And then he introduces the theme. And then it basically becomes a sort of theme of variations until the end. And each of the variations kind of shows off a different effect on the instrument. So it's a really fun piece, and I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you.